Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 3rd of April 2021, all right? And these lectures are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, because you require to answer the few questions related to your current affairs, general studies, right? For that, you have to study or any of your national newspaper like the Hindu or Indian Express. You can subscribe our channel on the YouTube also, where you will be getting these lectures on the current affairs on the day-to-day basis. So you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. All right. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay. So first news is related to the maternal death. Okay, everybody knows about the maternal deaths. Okay, the mothers or the pregnant woman basically dies during delivery or before delivery, right? Due to the complications related to due to the pregnancy. Now, what is happening is that now because of coronavirus pandemic, okay, the healthcare facilities are not reaching to the pregnant women, especially those women who are basically is about to go into delivery the baby. Okay, so there is a complete failure or there is a utter failure of your healthcare system in India. It is partially because of the lockdown measures which have been imposed by the union government, but simultaneously which have not been focused on the healthcare medical facilities specifically to the needy persons like the maternal or the mothers who are basically pregnant, right? So a study which was published in the Lancet Global Health Journal, which says that due to the coronavirus pandemic or due to the COVID-19 pandemic, the maternal deaths have increased. Okay. It has also says that the stillbirth also increased. So both maternal deaths as well as the stillbirth of the babies have increased because of the insufficient nature of the healthcare system facilities, right? So it's a total failure of the healthcare system. It is because of the insensitivity of the government towards the maternal needs. Okay. So according to the Lancet Global Health Journal, which says that overall 28% increase in the odds of the stillbirth. That means there are 28% increment or increase in the stillbirth of the babies. Okay. And the risk related to the dying of the mother or the mother which can die during the pregnancy or the childbirth has increased about 1/3. So you can consider that the chances or the proportion or the permutation is basically related to the risk of the mother's dying during the pregnancy have increased by about 1/3. So this is again a cause of the concern. Okay, the risk has increased. And there is also rise in the maternal depression also, right? Obviously, if you just completely close down everything without having enough, the measures regarding the medical facilities specifically to the pregnant mothers, obviously they will feel the depression. So because of the coronavirus, because of all the related health related implications, they also face the maternal depressions also. Okay, now it was this type of situation related to the maternal depressions or the rise in the number of maternal deaths or the stillbirth, right, is disproportionately high, specifically on the poorer countries. The Lancet Journal basically published this report after analyzing the 40 studies. These 40 studies are conducted, right, in 17 countries, which also include the Brazil, Mexico, US, Canada, UK, Denmark, Netherlands, Italy, India, China, and the Nepal. Okay, so it is after conducting the due study across 17 countries, this result have been propounded by the Lancet Journal. Okay, the Lancet Journal basically further says that this all related to the maternal death, stillbirth, or the maternal depression is attributing because of the inefficiency of the healthcare system, right? Their inability to cope with the pandemic. Obviously, the government has simply imposed the strict lockdown measures without taking care of the need which is basically there for the needy people, specifically for the mothers or which are basically pregnant. So this resulted in, you know, the reduced access to the care, specifically to the healthcare facilities. If you compare the data with the lockdown period, with the previous year period, okay. So in the months of the national lockdown, if you remember, the national lockdown was imposed, right, by the union government from April to the June. It was total complete lockdown, right? If you take this data from April to June in 2020, okay. And if you take the similar period in 2019, there was 27% drop in the pregnant woman receiving four or more antenatal checkups. So obviously, the checkups which are received by the pregnant woman is also declined. Okay, then in the similar period, right, if you compare, there is also 28% decline in the institutional deliveries. So obviously, if there is less institutional delivery, there is a chances of the mothers dying in the, you know, in such situation. And also 22% decline in the parental services also. So you can consider almost in every aspect, the service delivery was severely impacted because of this strict lockdown measures, which was imposed by the government without even taking care of the due consideration of the health related needs of the pregnant mothers. Okay, next, the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, this is called JCPOA. Okay, so this Joint Comprehensive Plan of the Action is basically related to the Iran. Okay, this is basically a deal which was signed between the superpowers, right, and with Iran. Okay, so it is a deal which is brokered between one side. You have almost all, you know, the superpower countries as well as with the Iran. The Iran is secretively, you know, enriching its uranium. Okay, it has the plans of enriched uranium in order to make the nuclear bombs. Okay, the US as well as other Western countries are basically concerned about, you know, this Iran's move of enriching the uranium specifically for the purpose of, you know, building the arsenal related to the nuclear arms. So what happens is this Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action was signed, and it basically restricts the Iran from enriching the uranium beyond certain limit. Okay, so it can only use for the medical facilities as well as for the civilian facilities. But what happens is, in 2018, the Donald Trump has pulled back, right, the US from this JCPOA, and which has led to the severe strain among the world powers, right, related to the fate of this Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. So what is happening is that now the new current president, Joe Biden, right, who has again shows his willingness, right, to negotiate on this platform, that is Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, through intermediaries. All right. So the US and Iran both, right, would begin the negotiation through the intermediaries next week. Obviously, to get back both the countries on the track, right, the simultaneously the objective is the limiting the Iran's nuclear program, right, that is around 3 years, almost 3 years completed in 2018, the Donald Trump pulled back itself. Okay, so this announcement, you know, is marked, you know, the major step towards, you know, the efforts to restore, right, you know, the deficit or broken, you know, belief between the countries, right. The accord was basically signed in 2018, right, which bound the Iran to restrict its nuclear program, right, and in return, the US, you know, would not put any sort of a restrictions or the sanctions on the Iran. Okay, what happens is in 2018, when the Donald Trump, you know, pulled back from JCPOA, right, what happens is, in return, the Trump also put maximum pressure, right? The US basically imposed maximum sanctions as well as through tough actions. Now, what happens is, this basically, Iran basically responded through this sanctions, which was imposed by the US, by intensifying its enrichment facilities of the uranium. Right, the Iran started building its centrifuges for the purpose of enrichment of the uranium. okay, which has led to, you know, obviously, you know, the major cause of the concern among the countries, right? So obviously, the main purpose should be for the purpose of the civilian and as well as for the medical purpose, and it should not be for the military purpose, or it should not be for the making of the nuclear bombs with the help of this enrichment uranium. Okay, now what happens is this Iran's move of enriching more uranium and building of the centrifuges, what happens is this increase the pressure on the major world power, right? Because of one side, Trump pulled back from the JCPOA, and second, the Iran started enriching the nuclear, the uranium, right? Which raised the tension, you know, among the US allies as well as the strategic partners in the West Asia region, right? So what happens is, obviously, meanwhile, in the 3 years, which was a vacuum, the indirect talks basically started. Okay, after European Union basically held, you know, some sort of a virtual meeting of the officials from the Britain, China, France, Germany, Russia, Iran, which have basically negotiated on certain platform virtually. Okay, so obviously, which remained in the accord, which was the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. Okay, the next, the new emission norms for coal-fired power plants. Now, what is happening is that, as you know, that because of the climatic changes, okay, because of anthropogenic nature of the climatic changes, right, there is a rise of the temperature, average rise of temperature on the earth. So what is happening is that, right, there is, you know, a lot of problems occurring, like depletion of the glaciers, like rising of the temperature, adversely impacting the human health, ecology, right, flora, fauna, everyone is affected because of this, and you have a lot of the health related complications also. So what happens is the Union government has basically put certain limit or put certain conditions on the coal-fired power plants, okay, which are basically thermal power plants, right, which generate the energy with the help of coal. So it has set a deadline that within that you have to install the flue gas desulfuration unit, okay. The flue gas desulfuration unit would basically cut down the emissions of sulfur dioxide from the plants. Obviously, the main purpose is to cut down the sulfur emissions from the coal-fired power plants. So what happens is, because of Corona and because of the resistance from the coal-fired power plants, the government has pushed back this deadline, right, which are supposed to be there from 2022, right, which is a deadline that to adopt a new emission norms, right, by 3 years. So it has pushed back, or it has postponed simply this new deadline to the 3 years, right? So it is just delaying. Okay, and the government says that the utility can continue to produce the energy, but they have to pay the penalty according to the notice. Okay, so India has set in 2017 the deadline for the thermal power plants to install the flue gas desulfuration unit. Okay, so obviously this flue gas desulfuration unit would basically cut down the emissions of the sulfur dioxide, right, which was, again postponed to the varying deadlines, which is basically going to end in 2022. Okay, now it has certain different measures, like, for example, the new order, which is basically comes at, you know, the 1st of April, which says that the plants which are there in the capital region, right, they have to be complying, right, as well as those plants which are there near populous regions, they have to be comply by 2022. Okay, and those power plants which are fired by the coal and which are, you know, located in the less polluting areas, they have to comply by 2025. Okay, if they are not complying, they have to retire units, right? So there is only option that you have to comply with such desulfuration units. Okay, and operators of the coal-fired power plants obviously are lobbying for the dilution of this pollution, you know, standards, right? Obviously, they are citing that there is a huge, you know, cost related complications related to such adoption. The Union government will set up a task force, right? That task force would be constituted by the Central Pollution Control Board, right, which is a regulatory board, and that will basically categorize the plants into the three categories, right? This categorization of the plants are based on the three categories on the basis of the location to comply with the emission norms, right? if those plants which are not complying with those emission norms, they have to pay the penalty, and penalty is around 0.20 rupees. That is 20 paisa, right, will be laid for every unit of electricity produced by such power plants. Okay, next, the Watergate scandal. Okay, this Watergate scandal basically is happened in 1972. Okay, so what happens is, you know, the US president at that point of the time, that was Richard Nixon, right, was involved in this Watergate scandal. So the former FBI agent as well as the Republican advisor, right, who was the mastermind behind this Watergate scandal, known as the G. Gordon Liddy, was recently died, right, at the age of 90. Okay, so what is Watergate scandal? The Watergate scandal, first of all, was a political scandal involving the highest level of administration in the USA, which also involved the US President Richard Nixon, and which also resigned, right, from the post. And he is the only US president who resigned after such scandal, right? So Richard Nixon was basically the US president from 1971 to 1974. Okay, now obviously the scandal is related to the Nixon administration try to cover up all sort of involvement of the corrupt practices, right, with the administration, as well as it was there in Democratic National Committee headquarters at the Washington, which is basically the DC Watergate office building. And that is why it is also known as the Watergate scandal. Okay. Now, after that scandal, the five persons were basically arrested, right? And it was the huge case was basically found with them at the time of the Nixon re-election campaign committee, right? And the Nixon was the only country's first and only president who got resignation after such scandal. Okay, so the Nixon basically resigns, and the Ford will take the oath as a 38th president at that point of the time. Okay, then you have the BIMSTEC. Okay, so, you know, Bay of Bengal, you know, multilaterals, you know, so the BIMSTEC basically, you know, is a platform, right? It's a platform which is basically, you know, for, you know, the Bay of Bengal region, specifically for the committing of, you know, the regional cooperation under the BIMSTEC framework. Okay, so the External Affairs Minister, Dr. S. Jaishankar, right, have told that the India is committed for building of momentum of the regional cooperation under BIMSTEC framework. Okay, now recently the 17th BIMSTEC ministerial meeting held virtually. Okay, and he expressed the India's willingness to cooperate, right, in terms of the regional cooperation, right, in terms of the cooperation in combating international terrorism, transnational organized crime, as well as illicit drug trafficking, right, which is basically come into the force last month. Okay. Then the BIMSTEC Convention on the Mutual Legal Assistance in the case of criminal matters are also finalized, right, for the signing at the 5th BIMSTEC summit. Okay. And these conventions would definitely provide the robust legal basis for strengthening the cooperation in this sector. Okay. As well as the BIMSTEC Center for Weather and the Climate was also being hosted in India. Okay, it is a state-of-art facility which will provide the disaster early warning, right, to the Bay of Bengal regions, right? So these are the countries, you can see India, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Thailand, Sri Lanka, which participated in this virtual meeting. Okay, next, the Harmonized System of Nomenclature Code. So what is that? It is basically a code which is also known as HSN code, right? It is a code which will be compulsorily has to put on the invoices, right, which are issued, right, on the business to business transactions, right, for the tradable or taxable goods and services, right? That means if the taxpayer, any taxpayer, right, who is in the trade, right, who is exporting, importing, right, so any taxpayer which have the turnover of around 5 crore or more, right, so that taxpayer would have to be compulsory furnished the six-digit harmonized system of nomenclature. This is known as SSN code, right? Or it's also known as Service Accounting Code or SAC code from 1st April 2021. That means the taxpayer or the person who is involved in the taxable goods and services export and import, right? And it has the turnover of 5 crore rupees or more in the preceding financial year, the such taxpayer must be furnishing the six-digit HSN code on the supply of or on the invoices, you know, the receipt, right? So on the invoices, they have to put the six-digit harmonized system of nomenclature or HSN code, right? Through the HSN code, we can basically track down, right, all such goods and services so that any sort of illegal and corrupt practices can be stopped in this process. Okay, so a taxpayer which is having 5 crore or more turnover in the preceding financial year required to be furnishing this HSN code on the business to business invoices. Okay, earlier there was a requirement of 4 digits and a 2 digits, but now it is compulsory 6-digit harmonized code. Okay, now this HSN code for the 6 digits are universally common, right? Which is universally, because throughout the world it is very common. Okay, the HSN code is generally applies to the customs, that means for the export and import. Okay, as LVLS, it will be applicable to the GST also. So HST facility or HSN such facility is also available on the GSA, on the GST portal also. Okay, and the manufacturers, importers, exporters, right, they are commonly using this HSN code. Okay, and they have to furnish along with the invoices this HSN code, which is mandatory for the business to business transactions related to the goods and services, okay, with respect to the export import as well as for the manufacturing of the goods and the services. All right, so you know, a large number of GST taxpayers are already furnishing this HSN code, right, which is 6-digit or 8-digit, but it is borne on the voluntary basis, right, on the invoices or through the e-way bills or through the GSTR returns. But now it is compulsory that they have to furnish this 6-digit universally applicable HSN code along with the invoices, right, with respect to, right, those goods and services which have been traded. Okay, then the Committee on Occupational Safety. Okay, occupational safety, all you know about, related to the health and the safety related parameters, right, related to the working conditions or the workers. So the central government has constituted a 3 expert committees, right? These 3 expert committees will look into the existing rules and the regulations which are there, right, with respect to the safety, health and the working conditions, the standards which are applicable to the factories, docks and the construction work, specifically where the workers or poor workers basically work. So these 3 expert committees will look into all aspects related to the standards, right, working conditions, safety measures, health related measures, right, with respect to the factories, dock and construction work. Okay, so one such committee will look into the safety parameters of industries, docks and the ports. Okay, and another 2 committees will be asked to study and suggest the rules for building and other construction and the fire safety standard. Okay, for the purpose, you know, suggesting the rules would be the major task for the other 2 committees. Okay, so these 3 committees will have the experts, and these experts will be, you know, the experts from the subject matter. So they are involved from the both public sector as well as from the private sector across the country. Okay, and a separate committee on the fire safety standard was also being formed, right? Obviously, for the purpose of giving comprehensive recommendations related to the fire safety provisions, the fire safety standards, right, which will have the holistic approach for the prevention of fire. Right. Obviously, you know, the many such fire incidents which is occurring in the workplaces. So to have the holistic approach to contain any sort of a fire related incidents, a separate fire standing, a separate committee was set up to evolve, you know, a comprehensive standard on the fire safety. Okay, so this all committees, after they recommend and based on that, we will establishing a uniform and updated standards, right, for the safety and the health of the workers throughout the country, and that will be uniformly applicable. Okay. Next, the All India Survey of Migrant Workers. Okay. So migrant workers, you know, the peoples, specifically the workers, basically move from the source regions, right? The source region to, you know, the destination. Okay. For example, from rural to urban. Okay. So that type of movement of the people is known as migration. And the person which are involved are known as migrant, or they are also known as migrant workers. So a survey of the migrant worker is going to be conducted. So Government of India launched the All India Survey of the Migrant Workers, as well as the All India Quarterly Establishment Based Employment Survey. Okay. Regarding this survey, so first of all, Labor and Employment Ministry, you know, basically going to conduct this survey. So objective of All India Survey of Migrant Workers is to study, right, the kind of the employment related migration undertaken by the workers. That means it will look into, right, what kind of the migration, what kind of employment related migration, what drives, you know, the workers from the source region to the destination, what kind of employment is there. So that type of, you know, findings will be noted down in this All India Survey of Migrant Workers. This survey will also provide the details of the working conditions, the living conditions which are faced by the migrant workers, specifically when they come to the destination region, right? As well as this survey would also look into the impact of COVID-19 on the work conditions, right, of the workers, specifically during the war. Okay, let's understand about All India Quarterly Establishment Based Employment Survey. So first of all, the All India Quarterly Establishment Based Employment Survey would provide the employment stats or employment estimates of for the establishment, right? Those employment or those establishment which provide, right, or which employ 10 or more workers, as well as those establishment which employ 9 or less workers. So it will look into the data that has led to, if any, changes in the employment situation. Right. So across, you know, the sectors, what is the changes in the employment conditions or employment situation, specifically on the quarterly basis? So it will look into the changes in the employment situation. Okay. And this survey will basically put, you know, plug in the data gap on the various aspects of the labor and the employment. And obviously, that data would basically help the policymakers or the evidence-based policy making process, specifically in the parliament, that will provide the much needed the data which is also relevant for the policy making, specifically for the good, you know, good policies with respect to those migrant workers, right? Specifically for the benefit of those the migrant workers. Okay, next, the Army War College. So as you know, that Army War College is basically, you know, is a prestigious training institution, is a prestigious research institution, okay, which is located at Mahou, Madhya Pradesh. Okay, so the Army War College completed or celebrated its golden jubilee. That means it has completed the 50 glorious years of its service, okay, or since its inception. So the Army War College is celebrating its golden jubilee, that is completion of 50 years of its service, right, as a premier training institution of Indian Army. Okay, now the Army War College is basically located at Mahou in Madhya Pradesh. Okay, it is a tactical training and research institution, belongs to the Indian Army, and is located in Mahou, Madhya Pradesh. Okay, and what this Army War College does, the Army War College basically develops and evaluate the concepts and the doctrines for the tactics which are employed by the armed forces during the war. Okay, as well as it will also help in the logistics for the Indian Army also. Okay, this Army War College basically trains about 1,200 officers which belongs to the Indian Army, okay, as well as the paramilitary forces every year. So every year it trains around 1200 such officers, which belongs to the army and paramilitary forces. Regarding its history, so first of all, this college was originally established as a college of combat at Mahu on 1st April 1971. Okay. And in 2003, it was renamed as Army War College Mahu, which is the premier research as well as the training institutions of the army. Okay, so it is the building of the Army War College. Okay, next, Good Friday. All of you know about Good Friday. The Good Friday this year observed on the 2nd April 2021. Okay, now, why this, what are the other names of the Good Friday? The Good Friday is known by also the Holy Friday, Great Friday, the Black Friday, or Easter Friday. Now, why, when it is observed? So it is observed, right? On the Friday just before Easter Sunday, right? Easter is the day when the Jesus Christ basically, get up, right? And the Good Friday is the day which marks the resurrection of the Jesus Christ. That means, right, the crucifixion of the Jesus Christ that was done on the Good Friday, right? After 3 days, Jesus got, the life, the Jesus Christ got up, right? After 3 days, that was marked as a Easter day or Easter Sunday. Okay, so why it is observed? As I told you that Good Friday marks the crucifixion or crucifixion of the Jesus Christ, right? And this led to his death at the Calvary, right? And the Jesus Christ was basically betrayed by the Judas and sentenced to the death. But what happens is the Jesus Christ rose again the 3 days later, which marks as a Easter Sunday. Okay, the Jesus was crucified on the Good Friday. Okay, on that occasion we celebrate Good Friday, and the Easter we celebrate because the Jesus rose up again, right? He got consciousness, he basically got life after 3 days of this crucifixion, and that after 3 days, and that Sunday is known as the Easter Sunday. Okay, all 3 days are also basically known as the Easter Triduum, or all 3 days of Easter. Okay, now how it is observed? So first of all, the Christians, because it is a festival of the Christians, mainly Christians, so the Christians observe this Good Friday with fasting. So they observe fasting. There will be church services. Church will provide various services to the mass. Okay, a special mass and the processions will be taken place across all major cities, across all major churches. Okay, a special bands which playing the sombre music, which is basically, a procession creating the atmosphere of mourning, because the Jesus Christ was crucified on this Good Friday. Okay, and this ceremony of the Way of Cross takes place as a reenactment of the scene from the crucifixion at the different locations of the church. So what is the meaning of good here, right? So good means here the pious or holy, pavitra, right? So good means here the pavitra or holy or pious. Okay, so what is the death of the Jesus symbolized here during the Good Friday? Is symbolized that the forgiveness of all mankind's sins, right? And the Jesus has taken the ultimate sacrifice for the good of all humans. So it is celebrated as a pious and a holy Friday for the sacrifice which was done by the Jesus Christ for the purpose of, the humans, for the purpose of all good of the humans, and which is also celebrated as a forgiveness for all human mankind sins. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much. We will meet again tomorrow for next current affairs. Thank you.